So I was just gonna ask, what do you think about that, and why do you think that we do those type things when we're faced with, okay, we're gonna implement this solution?
Well, there's a couple of things. One, a lot of it is delusion. You know, people are really delusional, and that in their minds they don't realize that just because they're now a part of a conscious collective, they feel that they've risen above those who they would say are in the hood. And that's really like a blanket term, the hood. Mm-hmm. Because the truth is, many people, even those who consider themselves conscious, are in the hood. So I think there needs to be a distinction made between those who are in the hood and those who have a hood mentality, because it takes you to, you're really speaking about a plantation when you're saying that. And on a plantation, you have those born, they have an innate fire towards freedom. They have an innate fire towards their own rights, their own human rights, their natural rights. And then you have those who look at the product and the condition, the manufactured culture of the plantation, and they say, well, this is just what it is. And then you have those who wish that things could be a little bit better, but they're looking for a messiah. So they're looking for someone to come back for them. You know, so you kind of get that conversation. What do we do about the ones still left in the hood? You know, an important question is, maybe an unpopular question, but an important question would be like, how do you know you're out of the hood? And I think that's a more secretive and mysterious notion, because a lot of times the people asking that question they know they're still hood. So they're basically saying, what about me? Are you gonna leave me?
Greetings all, and welcome to another segment of Chief Speaks on Enlightenment and Transformation. And my name is Chief Yuya, and I want to give you a reference for what you just heard. We began this segment with conversation that Kim from the community show that airs on the same network every Tuesday and Thursday from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. Eastern. We had a good bill session surrounding evolution and mentality and classism and standards. And I included a portion of that conversation in this show for you all to check out. But if you want to listen to the full show, the full conversation, the full build, and of course comment on it, you can do that on her channel. The full bill session that we had is on her channel, which I've put a link to in this video. So look in the description section of the video, of this video, and you'll see a link to her channel, Serious Bitch, on YouTube. All right. I want to welcome you all. As you know, this month's theme has centered around, last month we dealt more with family, but this month we're dealing with the mind of the magician. And as I gave a call out for anyone who wanted to ask questions in our last segment, of course, I got a bunch of questions. Well, about 6 or 7 questions that came in specifically on some of the things that I built on last segment. Show where I was speaking about the four primary realms of manifestation, or again, the four primary realms where you utilize your magic essence or your magic energy. So with that, I'm gonna start with a couple of questions. I'm not gonna get to all of the questions, but I'm gonna cover a few of them for you guys. And there was a few that came in that I thought were pretty good. Or at least interesting, to say the least. And you know, I like good questions. I like intelligent questions. Some of them that came in were very lazy, so I'm gonna ignore those. Whenever I receive questions asking me how to spell something, I ignore those. Or, you did this prayer or whatever, or this affirmation in this show. Can you write out what you said in the show? No, I'm not going to do that. All right. So, no, I think we've explained it enough. I don't think I need to explain anymore that I think sometimes you just learn by silence. You ask a question, you don't get an answer. You make a comment, you don't get an answer. And sometimes silence is a good instructor because it allows you opportunity to really kind of, internally build on what it is that you put out, into the world. Okay. So I'm going to get to the first question, which was Denise Mitchell. And, I'm saying names now only, so I'm just saying that so I don't scare anyone who sends in questions regularly. If you put them on YouTube, I'll say the name. And primarily I do that too in case someone else wants to respond to that person or strike up a conversation. But Denise Mitchell had asked, can the different realms or dimensions be compared to the different levels of Metatron's cube, seeing it on the microscopic or the micro level? Thank you in advance. So again, she asked, can the different realms or dimensions be compared to the different levels of Metatron's cube, seeing it on a micro level? So, not so much, but I'll explain. For those of you who are not familiar with Metatron's cube, I'm gonna give you a brief primer, but I'm not gonna give you the lesson. You can go, and there's a lot of information on the Metatron or the Metatronic cube that you can look up for yourself. So the Metatronic cube, brief primer, is really where we're dealing with sacred geometry, but it's a geometric configuration that shows the representation of how what's called the lesser Yahweh or the smaller deities manifest or create things. So you have this formation that has 13 spheres. And those 13 spheres represent the chief 13 archetypes that are necessary for creation. And this actual formation, this geometric formation, is really like a fractal because it builds itself outwards. So anything that's created has the components of that cube and then goes outwards and creates more cubes, more cubes, more cubes, more cubes, more cubes. So essentially, the what some would call the God essence or the deity essence is inherent in each moment of or each substance or matter of creation. There's a section in the 14 keys. There's actually two sections where I kind of spoke about this, but I couldn't find another section. I was moving quickly. And also the copy I have here is a pre-edit copy, so I might have added it later, but one that I have here, one passage, and this, for those of you who have the book, it'll be around like page 54. It's 54 in this copy, but again, it's a pre-edit, so stuff might have shifted a little bit. But in the section on Nia, when we're dealing with purpose, right? One of the things that I said is, when the divine enters a human experience, the divine seeks to amplify the experience to its rims. The expansion is what we call growth and evolution. If we envision ourselves to be divine beings, as created in the image of a divine intelligence, containing like elements of that intelligence, then our purpose will always be to elongate the restrictions of evolution that exist within every cell or within the cell of every conjuncture. In order to do this, we must be amenable to the innate fascination of the in/out dwelling personality we call God. Okay, so that kind of is related to what I was just talking about in terms of having that initial vibration or that initial tone and how that tone reverberates into every aspect of creation. So again, when you're speaking about Metatron's cube, that would be based on that school of learning the formation and the sacred geometry in that cube would be what would make up the astral realms and ethereal realms, or the ethereal body and the auric body, or even the physical body, or the emotional body, or the mental realm, and so forth and so on. This is how creation forms and comes together based on that understanding. Okay, so does it exist on a micro level? In a sense, but it's not the same theory per se. You know, Metatron's cube, or Metatron's cube, is the formation of creation, at its nucleic value. So, one of the most important things that you'll see with the Metatronic cube is that when you look at the formation together, what you find in the middle is, sometimes you look online, I think you'll probably see highlight. Yeah, I don't have an image of the cube in front of me, but you'll see like maybe a highlight sometimes where you'll see a pyramid that's formed in the middle of the actual cube. Well, that's a critical piece to the nucleic aspect of what emanates outward, and I'll explain. Again, remember you have 13 spheres, and each one is connected by lines. These are different paths, right? And these are the 13 archetypes, or when you study it, they usually say 13 archangels. You work it out. All right. So these are the images that are connected with, or the energies that are connected with that creation. But within it is a pyramid, right? So when we look at pyramid, pyramid coming from Kemetic Pimir, as we pronounce it. But in the Greek, it was Pimiris. Or Pimeros, you had different formations of it, even in the Latin. And a lot of times when you study, they'll say like, we don't know what it means. If you take it back to ancient Egypt, pyramid is because that was just a shape. And they just called that, just like, we got a square, we just call it a square. But everything is for a reason. So. Again, when you're looking at that pyramidal shape within that Metatron cube, right? And again, the key thing is the 13 spheres, right, around it. Pyramid actually means, it's really, really easy if you look at it in the Latin, which is pyromis, right? It makes it real easy. Or sometimes they even say pyromidus, but pyro is fire. Okay, so like pyrotechnic or pyromaniac, right? Pyro means fire, and midis, meos, mis means middle. So pyramid actually means fire in the middle, the fire in the middle. Okay, so when that is the originating inspiration and point of that actual fractal of Metatron's cube. It's the fire that sits in the middle of that pyramid, right? Now, again, Metatron's cube is also supposed to be a metaphoric representation of the human body. Remember, Metatron, meta means beyond, tron means matrix. So anybody, if you ever saw the movie Tron back in the days, that was like the first, one of the first Matrix movies, but Tron means matrix. So Metatron is beyond the matrix, or the metaphysical components that comprise the matrix, right? Or what is matrix? Matrix is that which is created, right? Anything, once something falls into the condensation and the compaction of creation, it becomes false, really, But even your astral realms, but these are the shapes and the formations that go into that creation, but it starts with the pyramid. Pyramid, again, being the fire in the middle. The 13 spheres is like puberty. You think about puberty for a second. When we think about that's why the number 13 is such a sacred number. And a lot of the work that we do, you see it pop up a lot, because it's considered, even like when you look at Hebraic culture, person becomes adult at the age of 13 because they go through that pubic experience. Well, that 13 actually represents those 13 spheres. And once one comes into that 13 spheres, they're now able to become the creator. So like a young man, now he's able to produce sperm, and a young lady, she's now menstruating, so forth and so on. So
that Metatronic cube, you see, it's like a fractal representation of even our experience of maturation, you know, as beings working on the earth, you know. So you can find puberty, you know, within Metatron's cube. So it's an originating fact, fractal. That's what that cube is. So I wanted to answer that one, and there's some more that I'm gonna get to. Okay, so I'm gonna go to the next question from Danielle Taylor, and she asks what she says, and then asks, "Thank you, Chief. I appreciate your time and explanation to the mindset of the magician. Your work goes recognized daily by who? As a viewer/listener of the archives and the current lessons, it helps put things in place on my journey. My question is in regards to the karma created through the patterns of the brain, the mind energies, and the astral plane. Are the practices, rituals done on the physical plane creating an astral body leading to an ethereal body? Also, how can you decipher between which realm, parentheses, ancestral, astral, 3D, etc., you are being pulled when going within, inner, and performing magic practices? Lastly, if you don't know which realm it's coming from, should you complete them based on you not knowing what karma you are creating?" Okay, good question. All right, so I'm going to start from a section on the 14 keys. And again, I'm reading, but it may be slightly different than some of your copies because it's a pre-edit. But I kind of spoke to this in this book. You know, 14 keys, it's really more like a little handbook. You know, it's not a Bible per se. And I almost originally, when I wrote, because it was a lot more pages, it's kind of almost the intention that I had. Like, I wanted to do a go for all holistic book, you know, and just kind of cover everything. But I realized after writing that I needed to cut it up a little bit. But definitely, like, things that we need to kind of point and check is there. And that kind of takes you back to Metatron's cube. You know, we use symbols because symbols provide a masking and a container for deeper philosophies, ideas, theories, and truths. You know, so sometimes it's easier to implant that into one symbol, you know, or into one letter formation. You know, you look at a letter and the alpha, beta, and one letter means a lot of different other things. It's a container of information. So just like 14 Keys is that type of book, really all the books are, but I did that, I think, more so with 14 Keys. It's very coded. So you read it and you think you're reading it, but you're doing more than reading it. It's opening up things inside of you. And then if you go back and really maybe focus on a sentence or a paragraph, you'll see that I'm saying maybe 12 things within three lines. You know, it's poetic in that sense. You know, but I am just going to I'm going to answer that question, but I'm going to preface it with this section because I feel like it, you know, it speaks to it. And one of the things I said is, and this is in the what section is this? This is creativity, Kuamba. And I said, our creativity mirrors a loftier thought, forethought. When we are not mirroring that higher intention, we run the risk of creating unconsciously. Let me say it right from the beginning. Our creativity, I got like all these scratch out marks, so I'm reading over my scratch outs. Our creativity mirrors a loftier forethought. When we are not mirroring that higher intention, we run the risk of creating unconsciously. Unconscious creation occurs when we are not creating from the pool of creative potential by inputting our full awareness into the ordering process. When this occurs, we are most often generating from the five senses bestowed on our human form. The scheme of creation is imbalanced as it reverses, well, this scheme of creation is imbalanced as it reverses the creation process. Creation is the gateway that transitions chaos into order by way of using the divine or God mind. When we create from the human awareness, we transition
order back into chaos. Derived disorder on the earth plane leads to confusion and ultimately imbalance. Okay. So, if we're creating from the material realm, as your question states, is that problematic? Certainly. The creation, it follows a certain trajectory. And if, like I said, if we're not creating from the higher mind, your creation should fall from higher to lower. Just like in your Oriopon, your answers fall from north to south, or from air to earth, or from Ori to Eshe. You know, so the eye, or head to foot, you know, head to leg. The idea again is that I'm creating consciously, and what I create consciously, I mean, whether I'm attempting to or not, whatever I'm creating with my aura, with my head, is going to create a physical projection. It's going to create a physical reality. You can't get away from that. In fact, what you're creating on the mental plane will also create things on the astral planes. You know, your ghosts and your boogie creatures and all that stuff like that. They will create things on different planes. So you really can't get away from it when you're creating from the head. Now, when you're creating from the root, often you create something that is devoid and lacking of that higher essence, which I think I addressed in the Metatron answer when I spoke about the originating fractal. That's why sometimes you look at young people today and you can look in their eyes and you really don't see a soul. You know, you really don't, because people are creating primarily from the root chakra. They're having children because they're afraid to lose somebody. Or like I knew a guy once that said that he felt that pregnancy was punishment for women, and that all women deserve to be punished. You know, he really hated women, you know. So and he has man, he's got like 6-7 children, something like that. You got like 6 or 7 children, last count. I mean, you might have more by now, you know. So imagine that. You got all these children that are created by an individual who is inserting himself and inserting his spirit and idea into a woman, and he's inserting his venom and his hatred for that woman. So he's not coming from this space where he's looking to reconnect with his twin half. He's coming from a different space, from a space of separation, a space of egoic binding. So what he creates now creates a bad karmic cycle, because it's created from the material realm. Okay, it doesn't have the balance of the material and the spiritual. When you create from the spiritual, or you create from the soul level, you're automatically going to have something on the physical level. You know, you can't, you really can't get away from it, you know, because you're housing something. Now, what am I housing if I'm creating from my higher consciousness? Like, you know, in Kemet, we have Perba and Perka, right? And the Perka was, you know, Ka is spirit or breath, and Ba is soul. So the Perba was the house of the soul, and the Perka was the house of the spirit. So one was related to the body, and the other one was related to the tomb. You know, but in any instance, each one referred to it being a house, it being something that enshrouded something that was living and alive. So when we're creating from that lower order, you know, we're not necessarily creating with live material. We're, you know, it's like trying to plant a dead cow. You know, and we say, oh, well, yeah, but things will grow from fungus and things like that. Yeah, but will another cow grow from it? Are we creating a fractal from that? And of course, you're going to have your smart Alex say, well, yeah, well, a cow can, you know, it could fertilize the grass. Another cow could come and eat that grass. And, you know, but. So you get what I'm saying. So, yeah, there are different modes of creation. Now, how do you know which one you're creating from, which was the second part to your question? Well, when you're creating, or when you're functioning as the I am, which is the key here, which again takes you back to the science of the 13. The 13, when you look at the formation of the names on that Metatronic cube, it has a numerical value. The numerical value is the same thing in our geomancy or Hebraic system as Shaddai. You know, some of you may have heard the term, especially those of you in church, El Shaddai, okay, which is like saying I am, you know. So having that I am reality allows you to see who's who. It's like being in an environment where there's a bunch of children and your children are there. How is it that you could be talking to someone and you can tune into the voice of your own child? And the same thing, your child, all the noise there, your child hears you going into your pocketbook or whatever for your keys. They know the sound of your keys. It's time to go. They know the sound of your keys over anything else that's going on in the room, because there's a connectedness through that creation process. You see, so the things that you create, you know. A lot of times people, they jump around a little bit too much when they come into the what they consider to be their spiritual consciousness. So the first thing I want to do is know about Orisha. And, you know, I think I've told this story a million times. Just go through my archives and understand my teachings on that. You got to deal with Ori first. Ori is your head. Who am I? And once you get that, then you'll know your voice. How many times have I heard people say, well, I'm following my spirit, as I watched them do something totally stupid? My spirit told me, you don't even know what your spirit sounds like. You don't know your spirit from your instincts, you know, or from your, you don't know your brain from your mind. You might have parasites in your gut, you know, so you're thinking wrong, you know, because when you got parasites in your intestines, it throws your whole thinking off. If you're constipated, if you have an impacted colon, it affects your mood. And then you can say, well, I feel it in my gut. You're feeling feces, you know. So part of it, obviously, you can imagine, is having a detox system and detoxing not only physically, but spiritually. That's when we get into the weighing of the heart, the meiotic, you know, aspect, and how light is your heart? You know, how much baggage are you carrying to the point that you can't hear? Like, you know, some of us, we have situations in our life where we're still traumatized over certain things so much that as soon as someone brings up something that sounds like it, we flip out, we go crazy. I don't wanna hear. And we just start going crazy. Because why? We're impacted, we're constipated with those repressed emotions. So you can't hear anything, nothing. And if you've ever met a priest or a priestess who's got issues like that, nothing they do is working. All right, I'm sorry to tell you, their readings are off. The spiritual work, it's all off, it's all wrong, okay? And I'm not calling out names and saying you like so-and-so, but I'm just saying you use your judgment, you know? And we see that a lot of times, man. You see priests and priestesses, and you can look at them and see that they're broken. And part of that is because a lot of times people use spirituality as an escape from character development. You know, I was going to do a separate video on just on that, and I might at some point, but I find that really in the quote-unquote spiritual community, or what we like to call a conscious community, it's a lot of lowlives. Because these are people who sat in organized religion, and when organized religion gave them rules to clean up themselves, because that's what organized religion, that's the best thing it does, it civilizes people. So when someone hands you something, you say thank you. You know, when you want something, you say please. You know, you take your shoes off, you respect other people's customs, you learn etiquette and courtesy, you learn how to be polite, at least you're supposed to. You learn not to sleep around, unless you're a whore. If you're a whore, that's a different designation, that's your job. But you learn not to be a slut, male or female, because, you know, it brings certain problems. You know, that's the same thing as, where are we creating from? Well, if you have a male who is unsure of himself, and or who's weak, or who is about gaining material resources, no matter how it affects other people, I gotta get mine. And then you let, as a woman, and you let that man inside of you, what happens is you take on some of his intellect. So now you find, you sleep with a couple of drug dealers, or you sleep with a couple of hustlers, you turn into a gold digger. Because now you got the same mindset. I gotta get mine, no matter what. You're taking on the character of that male. You know, so again, where are we creating from? It goes back to the original question. But those organized religions clean people up in that way. And the conscious community doesn't put those demands on people. So if you were in organized religion and you had a problem with lying, you were lying constantly. And people were saying, well, thou shalt not.
you know, or you will fornicate. Thou shalt not. I'm out of here. I want freedom. I need freedom in my life. I need to be happy. So you join the conscious community because there's nobody looking at you. And anything you do, you can justify as being some type of divine thing, you know. But that's how the low lives get in and stay in, you see. So, yeah, it's a little tricky in that sense. But you got to get your head right. And a lot of people don't go through that character building to really develop a relationship with Ori first. Once you develop that, it's much easier that you take it step by step. Now let's deal with my Egun. And you start to get used to their voices, what they sound like and how they move. And then you go from step to step to step to step. You know, you asked about, does that eventually create an ethereal body? Understand that there is a process, but the process is darn near simultaneous, practically. You know, like, as soon as you have a thought, you start to put things into motion, but it's so fast that it's almost like everything is happening at the same time. When you create causes for yourself in the physical, you know, you were asking about karma, does it affect you in the spiritual? Yeah, because whatever you did in the physical, it came from a spiritual malady anyway. There's nothing that you're doing here. You know, your spirituality or your spirit itself is the animator for your physical reality. You know, just like your Ori gives the charges for your feet. Your head tells your feet where to go. You see? So by the time you actually have a physical reaction, you've already created the cause for yourself, you know, because it started here. So that's where you got to fix. All right, so I think we covered that one pretty well. I'm going to get into this other one. It's more like wasn't a question, but it was I guess it was a question I asked. If any of you remember the Alpha Male videos, there was a comment that was left by someone, and they were saying, well, alphas like us, it was a woman, and, you know, she had started off a little rocky with some other stuff. So I said, I need you to assert, you know, a definition for yourself so I can see that you're actually an alpha before I answer a question based on that premise. You know, are you really an alpha? So I asked that question, and then it was taking a while, you know, and then I put a comment under one of her comments where she said, LOL, you called me out. Some emojis, I can't even see them. I will have to do a vid. Question, what makes me an alpha female? I will write a few bullet points. I don't want to make this comment long. Now I have to look at what I deleted, unless you remember. Yeah, she wrote, she said something out of pocket, and then she deleted it, but I saved it. That was before. So then, like, after that, you know, a good while, I said, we're waiting. You know, still waiting for this video or whatever it's going to be. So she replied, and she said, Chief Yuya, I feel like I'm just a natural born leader who was assertive at times. I am no periods. So you definitely no alpha grammar soldier. Chief Yuya, I feel like I'm just a natural born leader who is assertive at times. I am innovative and I made a critical thinker. I am a problem solver. I am call to action type person that jumps and when is needed. I do consider myself a warrior type, meaning I am self-sufficient. I am proactive. I'm resourceful. It's rare that I asked for help for most things. And I'm just confident yet humble when needed to be. I own what I do, even if I F-U-C-K up from time to time. I don't look for people to enable me. I do like others to be able to advise me or encourage me or try to push me in the right direction. You know, be hard on me in a good way. I don't do the baby thing or the pity party. Chief Yuya, I never really agreed with the term of alpha female at all, because I thought when people use it, it was more like this is a controlling, domineering, pushing type person. And then when I looked at the definition of it, I agree with everything it says except for having an assortment of men or not be able to stay with one guy, which is quite the opposite of me. Some of a few individuals, parentheses men, that I have come across or dated would call me that, but I know it was used as a negative connotation because they weren't used to a particular person like me. More emojis. Well, hope this helps. Sorry, late reply, take care. This is from Goldenflower. So, Goldenflower, you described a man. You have wonderful man-like qualities. You're a natural-born leader. You're assertive, innovative. You're a critical thinker. You're a problem solver. You're a call-to-action type person. You're a warrior. You're self-sufficient. You're proactive. Well, you said you're resourceful. That's feminine. You don't ask for help most things, but you are confident and yet humble when you need to be. Just not humble all the time, only when you need to be. You own what you do, even if you F-U-C-K up. You don't look for people to enable you. You do like others to be able to advise or encourage you or push you in the right direction. Not give you instructions, obviously, or not give you directions. Just a little encouragement or advice or a push. Be hard on you in a good way. So they have to be hard on you because of all those other strong qualities. They have to cut through that. So I don't need to go through all of this. So you are not an alpha female. Nope, you're not an alpha female. You've described the condition that many other women suffer from. You know, when I speak about the Amazonian women, everything you have here, it shows it, you know. But I knew that when you left your first comment, I could tell, you know, because there's certain things that an alpha wouldn't say. All right. So I said an alpha woman, just like an alpha man, is one who pushes the rims of their gender assignment. Okay. Now we have to get into what's a man, what's a woman. You got to go back and listen to the shows. It's going to help you. All right. So not just you, but a lot of people came and made that assumption. I'm an alpha. You're not. Just because you're bossy or because nobody gets along with you or because you think you're self-sufficient. And most, you never are. People just say that. I don't ask for help. I mean, I have people who tell me that who are on welfare. I don't ask anybody for anything. You're on the system or you're living with your mother still. Your mother's 85, 90 years old. You're in your 60s still living with your mother, telling her, I'm self-sufficient. You're not self-sufficient. And aside from that, that's not feminine. Okay, so I'm not dogging you, Golden Flower, but hey, you asked for it. You asked for it, sister. Yeah. And I'm not even going to get into it too much. And I know that part of this video is going to turn a lot of women off because, you know, you guys don't like when people tell you you're not doing something correctly. And what you just described is indicative, is endemic of a large group of females. That same large and in charge. And what's a warrior? You know, because if you have to say it, you ain't it. You know, so I'm just saying that there's a lot here. And I'm, you know, I decided I'm going to do a work, maybe a pamphlet or a video or something where I can get a little bit deeper into the qualities of men and the qualities of women. So at least from the Anu perspective, we have a common working definition. And I know outside of that, I mean, people will define men and women as many different things. Well, there's no definition, usually. It's just, you take care of your kids, you got a job, you know, can you cook? All right, you know, that good plantation, you know, debt mentality, you know, qualification. So being a man or being a woman goes beyond work assignment. You know, it goes beyond, I take care of myself. Well, you might be responsible, it doesn't make you a woman. You know, critical problem solver. I already shared that one. Women are not the problem solvers, they're the problem reporters. Now, many of them do attempt to solve problems and they mess things up because that's not their groove. That's not what they're there to do. And sad to say, a lot of times I don't speak about
where women should be or anything like that. I could, but I really would like other women to step forward and do that. You know, sometimes certain things can be blasphemous. You know, it's like me teaching my daughter how to put a maxi pad on. It's blasphemous. Could I look at it and forget it? I mean, the directions are right on the thing. I glanced and seen it before. You know, I think you got to pull, but it's on there. You pull out the wings and slap it in there and put some electrical tape around it and it's on. Whatever it is you do. But it would be blasphemous for me to do that. In the same instance, it would be blasphemous for a woman to try to teach a young boy how to put a condom on. You know, so sometimes with some of these things, I may not say, no, listen, a woman is da 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 da, you know, because it's just not the way to do it. But I'll let you know when you're off the path, when you think you got something that you ain't really got. Now, maybe in your community, and based on your perspective, this is it. Okay. All right. That's not a non-new woman. Definitely not. You described a man, you know, a male at that. You described a male, you know. Even the tone that you use and the profanity and stuff, you described a male. You didn't describe a woman. But like I said, I got to work coming on that, because I got to really, it's time that we have that discussion. Because if you don't get that aspect, there's so much you miss in all of this spiritual learning, the cultural understanding. And then when you got these fake leaders standing in front of you, this is another problem with a lot of you Amazonian females. You can't really spot a real man. You can't spot a real leader because you're in the way. Or sometimes you're looking for that weak leader. So that way you have something to do. You can still have a spot, you know, or you don't have to go into the spot that you don't want to go into. Because the real leader would say, all right, go over there. I need you over there. Or rather, I want you over there. Go over there. You know, the weak one will disagree with everything you got to say, and he might be doing a lecture or workshop. He'll let you cut him off in the middle of it and, wait a minute, brother, and, you know, do all that stuff like that. And I know that's so foreign to so many. You know, we're getting so far away from our natural positioning that, you know, and like I said in the book, the avatar of the teacher and the educator is like the most despised in the community now, because the avatar, the teacher and the educator is one that knows their position, and they usually can look like a chief and see where everyone else should be too in the community. And that's become a despised space, because everybody wants to just, like I said, the escape to the conscious community is escape to no accountability. You know, if it was really about accountability, you'd see more rites of passage programs. Because the rites of passage programs, we would be able to save you a woman or not. Not by that janky definition, because that wasn't it. That's not a woman, you see. But if we don't have an experience where we can say, well, listen, I've done this, I've done that, I've done that, I've displayed this, I've been able to answer that, and it's been confirmed by those who've also been confirmed right on down the lineage, you know, if I get that, I'm okay. It's like an elder presenting a mate to you and saying, listen, I tested this one, this one's solid. You know, no different than a mechanic selling you a car, right? You feel a little safer. You know, they kind of took it through the paces. They know what to look for. They know what to get, what not to get. You know, if it's a mechanic, you know, and you're close with, you could trust them a little bit more. So it's the same thing with this. And right now we're devoid of a lot of those experiences. And I know I have to put more attention to that at this time. I know that, because without getting that, we're missing some of the key tenets of the other stuff. Even something as simple as like how to approach me, how to speak to me. I had to speak about that on the last show. How do you speak to a chief or an elder or just an elder, someone who's 2, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 10 years older than you? You know, how does a man speak to a woman? How does a woman speak to me? It's not the same. You know, I know we want to unisexualize everything, but you got to sometimes look at where those concepts and those inklings that you have inside of you to do those things come from. You know, especially when you look into your cultural and ancestral legacy, you see, that's not what we did. We weren't unisex, and, you know, we did different things. And look at the great kingdoms when they started to fall. you're going to find some commonalities. You know what? We talk about Kimmon a lot. Look at some of the images of the citizenry of Kemetic society. Look at how the men were depicted, and look at how the females were depicted, or the women were depicted. You're going to find something common in most images. I gotta say it. You can hardly tell the men from the women in terms of body shape. You don't see a lot of muscularity in the men. I know a lot of people not ready for that one. And you might say, that ain't no big deal. It is a big deal. That's a big deal. Yeah. When men become so cushioned by the luxuries and the pleasures of what we consider to be a refined society, that they lose their edge. They lose their aggression and their grit, the things that help them to protect the perimeters and the corners of said society. Then what do they usually do in that situation? They outsource the security, like Kemet did, outsource the army, like we do. We got these policing agents. We outsource. You know, we don't cover our own community. We, a lot of us, scared to have weapons. You know, or if we want a weapon, we don't even know where to get one. Then if we get one, it'll take us another 3 minutes to figure out where to buy bullets. You know, we've lost so much of that, you know, and it translates into how we relate to each other. It translates, you know, how protective are we really, you know? I was speaking to someone recently. Oh, I almost forgot who it was. You know, because she was like hard-headed. Hard-headed women, it's like a blur. But she was saying something. I was going to offer her a job. And I said, you know what? She was saying something in the moment. I said, you know, I'll be honest with you. So I waited. I let her go. And I said, I'm going to tell you something that maybe you need to work on. I said, you might want to work on that giving men orders thing so much. You know, you do that a lot. And you kind of like to get up in my face. She's a short little woman and wave a little fist. And I said, you know, because honestly, I came here, you know, I came here to talk to you about some employment, but I see you type of person that if I tell you to do something and you don't understand what I'm saying, if it doesn't make sense to you, you're going to want to argue about it. And she was like, well, no, it's different if I'm talking to my boss or my father or my pastor or something like that. But so I said, but what? Why would I be any less than them? And I said to her, I speak to all women the same, straight across the board. Daughter, mother, aunt, grandmother, lover, parking meter maid. I'm never any less than man, and I never count them as any different than woman, even if they're not behaving like a woman. You know, so that's something that a lot of the males have lost or never had. You know, maybe they never even had it, and it creates a rumbling cycle. You talk about the building of a fractal and starting and building and creating from a bad place. It starts a rumbling cycle of the wrong thing that just keeps moving forward. You know, just the wrong type of attitude, the wrong type of gender theology, the wrong type of sexual ambitions and sexual campaigns. And it just keeps going and going and going. In any moment, be what you're supposed to be as a man. In any moment, be what you're supposed to be as a woman. Send that fractal out. Don't be so schizophrenic. And, you know, I'm only, like she said, well, my boss, yeah. Cause also, so you want to be a hoe. So for commerce, you'll pretend to be respectful. But if there ain't no commerce involved, then I'm going to be myself. And I said, just think about it. She didn't want to think about it. Well, no. I'm saying, but yeah, let's talk about the job. You know, let's talk about the job. Forget that. Let's talk about the job. I'm not talking about that anymore. I'm talking about the job. And I was like, just even in that. I said, you going to tell me what we're not going to talk about? I'm brought up. What are you talking about? And why would I hire you? You all that yip yap. No. Think about what I said. And I left. I was like, think about what I just told you. You work on that for a little while. You know, so golden fly pray thing of all this is about you. It's not all about you, Golden Flower. I deal with it a lot. Even some of the, I'm scrolling right now, even some of the comments that are on here have a seed of that in it. You know, we just don't know how to talk to each other, man. Males don't know how to talk to the females don't know how to talk to the males, and no one's standing in their right place. And so what happens is you have a foreign interest that come in and tell you what is, well, do it like this, do it like that. You know, you got a lot of males who watch porno all day. That's all they watch because it's easy to get on the internet now. So like back in the days, you had to go into a video store or something and, you know, with a trench coat on and some sunglasses and walk to the back and, you know, kind of sneak back there. So some males actually think the way you relate to a female is like how you would in a porno. You know, you go to her house to deliver a package and you tell her COD and she doesn't have any cash on me, so you pull out your penis and say, all right. You know, it's not like that. You know, and some females think that, again, because we live in a hyper-sexualized environment, that it's the same thing. You watch these movies where the woman will just, like, cross her legs. Like, if you watch the movie Lucy, there was a scene like that with Scarlett Johansson, and this in the beginning where she's locked up, you know, they got her chained up to a chair or something like that, and a guy comes into the room, and she just, like, spreads her legs and looks at him. And he's like, yeah. And he goes to lock the door behind him. And of course, she beats him up and everything like that. I mean, how many times have you seen that in the movie? The woman who's in handcuffs and like, oh, but come on, big boy. Let's just... No. Men are not turned on like that. But you see, that's the projection that's put out there that we're hypersexualized. So then when a female bats her eyes or, you know, bends over in front of you, you don't respond. She feels like, what? I did what I was supposed to do. You know, again, where we're getting our orders from of what makes us male, or what makes us female, or what makes us men, or what makes us women, a lot of times that information is coming from foreign interests for the purposes of just making fools out of you. You know, so that you'll never reach that 13. You'll never reach that place of true puberty, not just biological puberty, but where you can create and manifest as an adult. So they keep you closed. They keep you frozen in a very immature mindset. You know, and that's what your hell is. That's what your hell is. You keep doing something wrong. It's insanity. And, you know, you refuse to take on new light. And what is light? Light is fire. I've spoken about this before. So what does fire do? Fire heats things up and opens them up. You know, just like the fire of sexual activity. Just like sunlight. Think about how active and how productive a lot of us are when it's warm. You know, you ever sit in a cold house and have to do something? You don't want to get from, you might be curled up with blankets over you, you know, or like a snuggie things. They got the whole onesie thing they sell on late at night. And you don't feel like getting up and doing anything. Because it causes you to clench up and cold and close that cold. But when you're warm and you're hot, you're moving, you're ready to get things done. No different than your skin. You know, you put some hot water in your skin, your pores open up. You know, it opens up gateways. Maybe I'll break that down one day. Because that's actually related to the Metatron Cube and the aspect of the pyramid with the fire. You know, fire in the middle. It's related to opening up gateways and opening up portals. But yeah, so I just wanted to go through some of these questions in this show and again share some of that conversation that Kim and I had. And again, if you want to peep out the full conversation, it's very, like I said, a very good one. You can go to the link in the description, and I'm sure there'll be a post on Facebook and all of that stuff, or Twitter and so forth and so on. Also, those of you who are working your way through the 14 keys, you know, your reviews help. So on Amazon, please leave a review. You know, leave a positive view. Sometimes people get the works, which is cool. You know, not, you know, and they'll email the review. Like, I just want to give you a review in a book. That's cool. I do appreciate it. But it actually helps a lot more when you let the public see what you thought of the work. Okay. So yeah, positive reviews help, because without that, nobody really knows what it's about. You know, nobody really knows what they're reading. And, you know, we live in a different age now. You know, we just kind of live in an age where, you know, we share information differently. It's not about me standing saying, you need to get the 14 keys, it will change your life. Because you guys know, I really don't promote my stuff like that anyway. It's like, here, I consider them all offerings. Like, here, if you want to fix something or whatever, it's there for you. If not, it's cool too, you know. But if you are passionate about the work that we're doing and you're excited about it, please share it. Share the videos. Comment on the videos. Because other people see those comments. Sometimes, and I'm sure you guys do this, you might start watching a video on YouTube. And in order to understand what it's about, you'll read the comments while the video is playing. It's like, okay, what do they think of this? You know, what are they talking about? The books are the same thing, you know. So definitely on Amazon, whatever, leave your positive reviews. Whether you got the Kindle version or the paperback version, whatever, whichever one it is, leave your positive reviews. Your negative reviews, those you can email. Emails and we'll take a look at them, you know. But because you guys know I'm open anyway to feedback and things like that, as long as it's respectful. So yeah, man, that was pretty much all I wanted to cover as far as the manifestation and the mind of the magician. You know, I want to just say one thing that's probably most important is that the mind of the magician is an open and balanced one. You see, so when you hear me speaking a lot about character, right, and mental mastery, it's important. You know, a lot of times, again, I know we skip it, again, because a conscious community becomes our escape. Oh, I don't have to stop doing it. I have to stop doing that. Oh, and you can almost look at the conscious community like, okay, well, what? It's like high school. Like, what crowd do I fit in? You know, if I still don't want to let go of that Bible too much, okay, I'll join the Hebrew Israelites. You know, if I'm mad at the Bible and what they did, I'll become a Muslim. And then when I'm tired of all of that and the rules, then I'll say, okay, well, I'm just dealing with energy and the laws of attraction. You've seen the movie The Secret. Oh, my goodness. You know, it'd be that type of thing. Then I'll get into the Yoruba thing when I want to go. I feel like I'm going far left. Let me get some African voodoo. You know, but then some elays you go to, you know, them money, them costs start hitting you for the ebos and things like that. So then you leave the Europe, but then you start saying, well, I'm studying the comedic sciences. And you start studying the comedic sciences until something happens and you need some spiritual work done. Then you go to the Akan, or you go to someone who practices voodoo, or you go back to the Europe. It's going all over the place. And, you know, a lot of great development and strength could come if you just got your mind right. Let's get your mind together. You know, those messed up parts about your character, you know, your anger, your hostility, your jealousy, your guilt, your self-absorption, your selfishness, your self-centeredness. We just go down a list, you know, your confused sexuality, you know, your laziness, you know, all of those different things we could go through. And if you kind of clean up that stuff or address and deal with those things, you'd be surprised spiritually how much easier this work gets, because you're approaching it in your proper form. You know, it's like being 4-4-1 and trying to drive a car. It could be a little bit difficult because it's not made for you. It's made for people of a certain size. And you can find a smaller car or something, but, you know, you 4-1 and you're trying to drive around an Escalade. It's, you know, it's going to be a little difficult for you to even just get into it, you know. So, but you could pretend. And that's what happens a lot of times. People pretend, but they're smashing stuff up because they can't see over the dashboard. So they're saying, okay, well, let me give do an offering to this one. Let me burn this to that one, that one. You can't even see what you're doing because your mind is not clear, because your aura is not together. You're just throwing out energy to any spirit that feels like it raised some goosebumps on your arm or the hair on the back. You know, oh, here, you here? Oh, here, take this. Take that, take that, take that. You driving blind, can't even see over the dashboard, and you smashing and crashing into everything. And then eventually you'll come and you get a reading. You say, well, my life is so messed up. And then I'll say, okay, it's time for you to grow up. What? Grow up? And, you know, and then it starts all over again because now you're offended. You know, but that's what happens in the absence of a real community. you know, people don't really know who they're supposed to respect sometimes. And like I said, if you give it across the board, it becomes easy. Like I said, I'm gonna treat all women like women. I'm gonna treat all men like men, you know? And if it makes you uncomfortable, then you'll get away from me, which is fine. Or you'll rise to the occasion. But I'm not gonna do some weird stuff like, because you know, we go to the, I know I use this example, but the Caitlyn Jenner thing. That's Bruce Jenner. Come on, man, that's Bruce Jenner. Just because he says, well, you're Bruce Jenner, man. You're not autistic. I don't have to play along. You're not a child, you know. You got too much money. That's rich white man stuff. You know, like, I'm bored, you know. And it's like your holy land, America or England. It's like, well, we got money, so it's not like I got to focus myself into repairing my holy land, you know. So I'm just going to find something insane to do. You know, I'm going to treat you the same across the board. And I know sometimes that could be frustrating because some of us have parents at home who do that. You know, I named you, Clarence, I'm calling you Clarence. But, you know, it's different because we're acknowledging evolution, you know, versus really sneaky desire for the ego to sneak itself within your consciousness. There's a difference there, you know. Don't use the conscious community as escape, and you'll be surprised how well you'll be able to look at the quote unquote leaders of the conscious community and see what they're really about. You know, I want you to pay attention to something, man. Like when I was doing a guest on the new Asafo, a lot of people I didn't bring on that show. People would say, oh, because a lot of people I know, like, oh, you can have such a commercial distance. Nah. Mm-mm. Now, some of the people on that show, I don't agree with. I probably wouldn't have, you know, because I gave them a little freedom later on, you know, more freedom later on to pick and choose. And they were just grabbing, like, the wrong people. Let's just say that, you know, and eventually I said, okay, no more interviews, you know, which helps to grow your situation. But you'd be surprised when you walk in your proper gender assignment, what you really see amongst those who consider themselves to be the leader class. You can really see what's happening. You can really see what's going on. Like when someone says they're a warrior, you can look and really see a warrior. You know, if you've ever been in a war, you know the ones that were sitting there doing nothing, and you know the ones that was doing something. I could tell by the way somebody walks if they're tough. You know, big jaws. You know, some of us are born to get hit. No neck, big jaw. So you're not going to knock me out. You know, you're not going to snap my jaw. You're not. No, because I'm made for damage. You know, so if, you know, not to say to someone who looks. Well, yeah, I'm going to say it. Because even you look at the pretty guys, you look at a Sugar Ray Leonard or whatever, you know, you could still look. This is you can see where he walks, see where his facial structure. This is a tough guy. You know, so if we're not used to being in that world, we get lost. We can't see over the dash. So anybody can shout up and say, I'm a leader. I'm a this. I'm a warrior. I'm a that. And we don't really know what it looks like because we haven't engaged in that work. So we don't know what's required of those people. You know, you get a lot of guys who call themselves leaders and they're really emotional. You say something in their like YouTube video comments and they'll go off. They'll make like 3 more videos on you. A leader wouldn't do that. You know? Even some, when you look at the femininity, look at the physiognomy. Physiognomy tells you a lot. You know, when someone says they're a woman or they're a man, do they sound like a man? I mean, I was listening to one video recently, this guy, and every video, man, he's just going in on American black woman. Like, every video, like, it's nothing redeeming, you know? And I swear the guy, I mean, I don't get any sense of manhood from him. Like, I can't picture him going up to a woman and saying, hey, I like you. You know, I don't hear it. You know, there's no bass in his voice whatsoever. You could tell just from hearing he's a little guy. Not that means something, but we got to add the physiognomy together. You know, and he sounds very, very feminine when he talks.
And, you know, to be sitting there complaining about your compliment for that long is gay. It's gay. You know, and then sometimes I see some of the females who do the same thing. Voice sounds like mine. You know, I'm looking at them. Yeah, you know, these brothers got to learn to respect the goddess. Nah, man, you sound like DMX. You know, nobody wants that. So we actually start to terraform ourselves. We start to change how we look like, you know, what we sound like, and because we're so off-kiltered with the assignment that came down from the Ori. So the feet are just walking with no instructions. And like I said, foreign interests will always turn you around because it's profitable. So the mind and the magician is a balanced one. You gotta be balanced, and you gotta respect and enjoy and love what you came here to do and what you came here to be. That's a key part. You know, if you spend your life fighting that and denying nature, you never really get a chance to get to the magic, you know? And you're disrespecting that pyramid that's inside of you that created that original fire and that Metatron cube that creates that fractal going out. You're blocking the fractal process. So it's got to now create fractal reality around your egoic ignorance until eventually egoic ignorance is crushed. That's usually that gargantuan, woeful event that you have in your life that now finally makes you want to pay attention. You know, who needs the hassle? Just get it right the first time. So yeah, you know, I'll be building more on that with you guys, you know, because it's necessary. I see it. It's necessary. A lot of us don't have maybe elders who've ever sat us down and spoke to us about character and integrity and morality and masculinity or femininity. I mean, how many of you have had parents who've literally taken time to sit you down on a chair or come into your room and sit on the edge of the bed and speak to you about what it is to be a good person or what it is to be a right person or the family agenda or what it is to be a woman or what it is to be a man? How many of you just kind of stumbled into it? You know, how many of you have mothers that said, okay, listen, you know, let me teach you how to do this, let me teach you how to do that. You know, I have boys and girls. You know, my youth, they get those lessons. They, come on, we're going to sit down, we're going to go for a walk. This is the subject, this is all we're talking about. This, right here. You know, I remember one time having a, this, man, it was much younger. But, you know, when you know your youth, you know their development route, especially when you have advanced youth, you know they're going to move a little faster than other youth. You know when to bring up certain subjects. But I remember talking about the mind frame you had to have when you were getting ready to engage a woman sexually. You know, like how to clear your mind. I remember having that conversation with them, and I had a friend over at the time, and he just thought, he was like, yo, what are you, like, you crazy, what are you doing? I was like, listen, man, I got this, you know, and he's married. And I said, my youth are going to be excellent lovers, you know, especially the boys. A girl or a woman is not going to walk away and say that the D was trash. No. You know, and I told him, you come from a line of good lovers. No, you're going to learn. You're going to get your mind right. You're going to know how to do certain things, because these are some of the things that will help to save your marriage one day. You know, it's a holistic thing. It's not just that. You know, you also learn how to fight and this and that, and how to manage money, how to build businesses, and how to mediate problems and issues and things like that. Critical thinking is very important for me. Like, that's my main thing. But that one thing right there, and for him it was foreign, because he was like, and I asked him, I said, who taught you how to make love? He's like, yeah, I figured it out, right? You know, while he's having marital issues, right? You know, so, you know, things like that sometimes, and I know it may seem far, but as men, that's conversations you got to have. You may not have it, obviously not going to have it in front of your mother, but you got to talk to him about things like that, you know? And I mean, the conversation was more vulgar than I'm saying, but you know, but I mainly that, I remember that day I was talking about the mind. What is the mind that you put on when you're getting ready to go into battle? you know, how should you be thinking? I spoke to him about, you know, make sure she has some fruit by the side of the bed. Drink up so you can, you know, regenerate quickly. Drink a lot of water. Like, if you know you're planning it, drink a lot of water that day so your count is high and you know, you're ready to rock, you know? How many of us had that? And I mean, on the feminine aspect, there's also those other lessons, which I'm not going to speak on because it would be blasphemous. But I would just say, how many women, aside from how to put on a tampon or a maxi pad or don't get pregnant, how many of you actually had a mother who sat down and said, okay, this is what it is. You know, not this is why it's so great to be a woman, but this is what it is to do it and be it. And this is how we represent. You know, this is what our family represents in terms of femininity. When a man marries us, this is what he's getting. You know, and let's go through it. Or how do you deal with certain things with men, or, you know, so forth. Or what's the mindset you should have when, you know, you're conjoining with a man. I had those conversations with my daughters too, no different, you know, but it was in a different setting than with the boys, you know, and told them, listen, man, you really don't know. But anyway, family secrets, right? You know, but you got to teach your youth, you know, those tenets. But I see that because a lot of us didn't get that, I'm going to have to speak on it. You know, I'm going to have to do some type of work. I'm not sure yet where we can kind of get that clear, what's what. And then we can move forward with some of this other work from there. So again, the mind of the manifester or the magician is an open one. And it's a balanced one, but it's open. It's flexible. It's ready to make whatever moves it needs to manifest whatever it's trying to manifest. And it learns the laws of different realms. You know, that mind, so it learns how to make things happen in different realms. You know, that's what your work is, like your Orisha work and things like that. And when you're getting in these initiations, hey, we're opening up the mysteries of this one to you, that one to you. You're learning the formulas that work in that realm. Just like you go through your zodiac cycle. What are the formulas that work with those different realms? You might have been born into the realm of Cancer, or born into the realm of Sagittarius. But you're traveling through different realms and they all work together. You got to learn the formulas for all of them. All right. Well, that has been our Chief Speaks. I want to thank you all for listening. And absolutely, if you're not a student of the Anu Spiritual Training, sign up. And I want to give a shout out to all the new students. And you see, you know, I'm being looked for. I got all these bleeps going on. And, you know, certainly get your copy of Grasping Root of Divine Power, Solutions for Dysfunctional Family Relationships. Speaking of, you know, what we're talking about, Shrine and Altar, and 14 Keys, of course, you know, get your care package. Okay. You know, let's get it right. This Roman financial new year, we're going to make some different kind of things happen. It's time, because we're resetting. This Roman New Year, we're going back to the 10 vibration again. Now we're dealing with the 9, we're going back to the 10. So now it's like, okay, take everything you've gotten, and now we're starting over. We're going to be dealing with the 1 and the 0 now, the 10. So it's family, that's coming together with the, you know, that off and that on, that duality. All right, so I want to thank you all for listening up into this moment, and thank you all for your comments. The ones that I didn't get to, I will get to. I'll finish them. But I knew the ones that I did answer, I wanted to give extended answers, so I didn't want to cut them short. All right, but thank you for the comments. Keep them coming. You can put them on this video, and make sure you share it, make sure you like it. And for those of you who are vibing on, like I said, the Sadulu House channel, please subscribe to that channel. I got more stuff coming. Just like this one too, you subscribe to, you know, we got these like impromptu videos. We're doing more. We're going to start doing more of them, but we already started, as you can see. All right, everyone, be safe and be well on this Sunday.